morning. We're glad you're here for this worship experience. If you would, please stand with us and hear the word of the Lord. The psalmist says, I will praise you, O Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of all your wonders. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. The Lord reigns forever. He has established his throne for judgment. He will judge the world in righteousness. He will govern the peoples with justice. The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. And those who know your name will trust in you. For you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. Sing praises to the Lord enthroned in Zion. And let us all proclaim all the nations what he has done. Let's worship him as we sing.
Join in singing together this morning.
Awake my soul. Yeah, hello. Hey, church family. Thank you so much for being with us this morning, and happy Fall Back Sunday. I know the Red Raiders could certainly use an extra hour of sleep after yesterday's game. You know, late in the game, I may or may not have seen Pastor Bobby lean over to Cliff and be like, you know, I got an extra year of eligibility. Dunking people all those years in the baptistry really keeps the arm strength up. So you never know. Pastor Bobby as quarterback might be pretty cool. If you're with us this morning, you're a guest, there's a card you can fill out that you can turn in during the offering. At this time, we're going to go ahead and direct you to the screens. We have an announcement for you about an opportunity to serve later in December. All right, so this year we are having a Christmas store to reach out to the community around us. If you would like to get involved with that, if you would like to volunteer, you'll have an opportunity after service in the foyer. So go ahead and sign up for that. Go get some information. Figure out if that's something that you would like to help out with. At this time, why don't you go ahead and greet the people around you, shake a couple hands, and tell them, man, do you think you could kick field goals for the Red Raiders?
Why don't you remain standing and let's continue singing today. You're the reason we're here.
Oh God.
Let's sing that chorus one more time with just our voices lifted up to Him today, okay?
Lord, I need You. Oh, I need You. Every hour I need You. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need You.
Oh, God, that's the cry of our hearts. And may it be always the cry of our hearts, not just when we're gathered with these we love. God, may that ring true for us every moment of every day. We need You more than anything else, way more than anything else. We need You, oh Holy Spirit, to guide us, to walk with us. We need You, Jesus, to gather us up in Your arms and remind us of Your love. Oh great God, our Father, we need Your reassuring touch. That You are who You say You are, and You will do what You say You'll do. It's in Your name we pray. Amen.
All right, anybody peek during the prayer when you saw the crash up here? Oh, I guess it was just me on the front row. All right, hey, glad you're here. Good seeing you. And Josh, you'll want to know that during your welcome time, I noticed about a dozen or more of our football players that were very amused by your humor, and they said they'd love to meet you out in the foyer after the service, see if you have any more material you'd like to go through and test on them. Oh, you guys be gentle. Heard the story of a neighborhood that was being terrorized by two brothers, an 8-year-old and a 10-year-old, and it seemed that everything that happened in that neighborhood could always be tracked back to them. And the parents were really at their wits' end. They didn't know what to do, so they asked their pastor to get involved and if he would be willing to meet with these two rambunctious boys. And he said, yeah, but he said, my approach is I want to deal with them one at a time. And he said, I want to start with the youngest one first. So the 8-year-old goes into the pastor's office and he sits down in a chair. Instead of sitting there side by side, the pastor goes and sits on his side of this very imposing, intimidating desk, and he just sits there and stares at that 8-year-old. And it becomes very uncomfortable. And they sit there and stare at each other for about 5 minutes. And finally, the pastor says in his deepest, most intimidating voice, young man, where is God? The little boy started looking around. He looked underneath the pastor's desk. He looked underneath his chair, and he didn't say anything. The pastor said again, young man, where is God? Again, the boy just looked around. He was really kind of perplexed and didn't offer any answer. And finally, the pastor stood up a third time and reached across his desk and pointed his finger at the young boy. He tried to get as close to his nose as he possibly could. Young man, where is God? With that, the 8-year-old jumped up and he bolted out, ran all the way down the street to his house and grabbed his brother, ran him upstairs. He said, man, we are in trouble. God is missing and they think we did it. Now, in Genesis chapter 37, I tell you that to say that in Genesis chapter 37, we are introduced to some delinquent brothers. And these brothers perpetuate, they instigate some things upon one of their own to a degree of such injustice and unfairness, it perhaps will leave you wondering if God is missing. I want you to listen to these first four verses of Genesis chapter 37. It says, now Jacob lived in the land where his father had sojourned, in the land of Canaan. These are the records of the generations of Jacob. Joseph, when 17 years of age, was pastoring the flock with his brothers while he was still a youth, along with the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought back a bad report about them to their father. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his sons because he was the son of his old age and he made him a very colored tunic. His brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, and so they hated him and could not speak to him on friendly terms. It's interesting to me as we read the story of Joseph and as we explore this biographical sermon this morning on the life of Joseph, and it's really unfortunate, I think. We're only going to do one sermon on these biographical series, one sermon per person. But like Abraham, we could have camped out there and done several messages. Joseph, certainly, we could camp out and do four or five messages. But I want us to look at this relationship a bit closer, because as I read these first four verses, especially as I understand the background of Jacob, it is a little bit perplexing to see that Joseph has been deemed the favorite son. He's the son of his father's elder years. He's the second youngest son in the family. And to see that Jacob is exercising favoritism is really perplexing, because Jacob understands what it is to be on the short end of favoritism. His father Isaac loved his brother Esau. We know the story of Jacob and Esau. We know that the father Isaac showed great favoritism to Esau. And so Jacob understands what it is to be wounded. And you would naturally think that having gone through this, Jacob would have said in his own mind, in his own life, you know, when I become a dad someday, I'm not going to put my child through that kind of pain. I don't want any child of mine to go through that kind of suffering that I went through of being the least favorite child, and I don't want any of my children to experience that. But what we find so often is that families can fall into patterns that constantly repeat themselves generation after generation after generation. Certainly, I don't think any parent enters into the parenting role trying to favor one child over another. The unique personalities of any child will sometimes require more of us as parents, more emotional investment. The personalities of some of our children just demand more attention. And certainly that could be misinterpreted by the other siblings as favoritism. But you would think with this background, Jacob would have said, you know, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to treat each and every one of my children favorably. But Joseph was his favorite. And he gave him this ridiculous looking coat. And here is Joseph strutting around in his multicolored tunic like a peacock at the San Diego Zoo. And he's flaunting it in front of his brothers. And to make matters worse, and really on the front end of this story, I'll tell you, Joseph is the guy that I just don't like. Joseph is the kind of guy that is very easy to dislike. He's the favorite sibling. He's the pampered child. And he's a tattletale. Nobody likes a tattletale. Nobody likes those kind of individuals who are always throwing people under the bus to make themselves look better. And to make matters worse, to really top it off, all of a sudden Joseph is having dreams. And in this dream, he's saying to his brothers, you know, someday you're going to bow down at my feet. You can imagine how well that was received. But that's the nature of the youngest sibling, the one that's always at the bottom of the totem pole. He always has a mentality and an idea. You just wait, your day's coming. That's the way that the youngest one seems to always cope in family dynamics. You just wait, my day is coming. I have a younger brother, 5 years younger than me, and we really didn't get close until after I had left to go to college. And we had a very antagonistic relationship, and I always felt like I was being stuck with him, take Barry with you, and all this kind of stuff, typical stuff. And we had a very antagonistic relationship. But I remember my brother would always say to me through our growing up years, you just wait till I turn 16. He said, when I turn 16, I'm coming after you. Like something miraculous was going to happen on his 16th birthday where he thought that he could lick his older brother. But I remember him all, that's the nature of the youngest one. You just wait. And so that was the dream of Joseph. And he was flouting and flaunting these dreams to his brother. And not just his brothers. Not only are you going to bow down at my feet, all of our family will someday bow down before me. Well, that went over like a lead balloon. So the brothers start plotting. How can we get rid of this guy? One day they're out in the field. They see Joseph approaching alone. They come up with a plan to take him and to throw him in a pit. Because of conscience or whatever, they couldn't bring themselves to kill their brother, but they threw him in a pit until the Midianites came by, and they were coming by on their way to Egypt, and they sold their brother Joseph into slavery, sold him to the Midianites for 20 pieces of silver. They knew he wouldn't last long in slavery, this one who's been pampered all of his life. He's soft. He probably won't last. But they knew they had to come up with a story because he was Jacob's favorite child. So they took that multicolored coat, that multicolored tunic. They covered it in blood, took it to their father, explained to him that their brother had been attacked. He had died. And this is what remains. And Jacob swore that he would mourn himself to death. Brothers didn't really anticipate that kind of mourning. All they knew is that the problem of Joseph is taken care of. Now then, no more silly coat being paraded around, no more tattling on us, no more flaunting these dreams before us. This kid got what he deserved. End of story. Not quite. If you turn towards the end of this chapter, chapter 37, there is a word that I want us to think about. There is a word where I want us to camp out this morning. It's a word that may not have meaning for you now. It may not have weight and significance for you today, but it will. I promise you. It will. It says in verse 36, meanwhile, the Midianites, to whom the brothers had just sold Joseph, meanwhile, the Midianites sold him in Egypt to Potiphar, Pharaoh's officer, the captain of the bodyguard. I want us to camp out, and I want you to think about that word, meanwhile. Because while these brothers thought the story was over, while they thought in their mind they had resolved the issue, the word meanwhile comes to say the story isn't complete. Meanwhile is a word that comes to remind us of the old cliche, it's not over till it's over. When we see the word meanwhile, it's a door of opportunity that has been opened. And just as the word meanwhile will become the most significant part of the story of Joseph's life, I want you to hear me say this morning that when adversity comes to your life, when hardship comes, when your life is sidetracked, when you have to deal with detours that you never anticipated, just like meanwhile became a part of Joseph's story, meanwhile will become a part of your story as well. See, the word meanwhile is a wonderful affirmation of our faith. The word meanwhile offers affirmations to us in a variety of ways. The first thing that I see in this life of Joseph, the first affirmation I see, and knowing the story of Joseph as it's going to unfold for us, is the word meanwhile. Meanwhile always affirms for us the hidden hand of God. Meanwhile affirms for us the hidden hand of God. With this one simple word, within this one simple word, lies a profound reality that God is at work, that there is an agenda hidden from us, but assures us time and time again that God is working. Remember, we just came through 1 Corinthians. In 1 Corinthians, Paul is reminding the church of this. Paul said to us as believers, he says, we know in part, we prophesy in part. He says, you and I, as we live life, as we experience life, as we interpret life, he says, we see through a glass darkly. And Paul has the maturity and wisdom, and he's hoping that we will capture this kind of maturity and wisdom, that when adversity comes in life, when circumstances in life are working against us, human nature is to allow the circumstances of life to blind us to what God is doing. That beyond our pain, beyond our lack of understanding, we can be sure that God is working. It was true for Joseph. His brothers, they think he's gone. But the hidden hand of God is working in ways they've never imagined. They thought, because we've sold him off to the Midianites, it's done. But lo and behold, he's sold off to Potiphar. Potiphar's wife falsely accuses him. He's in prison. When he's in prison, he meets a cupbearer and a baker from Pharaoh's household, from Pharaoh's court. He has the opportunity to interpret their dreams. He has the opportunity to eventually interpret the dreams of Pharaoh, to be awarded a place of prominence and power. I mean, for the next 13 years of his life, all of this is unfolding, unfairness and injustice unimaginable. And yet eventually he finds himself at a position of prominence, a position of power, where in fact all of his family would bow down to his feet. It comes as a needed affirmation whenever we encounter our meanwhile moments. That in the meantime events of our life, we need to be assured of the hidden hand of God. You see, it also affirms that God is always doing something. That there is something that is always going on. That's an affirmation that we have, that in the circumstances of life, there is always something going on. The hidden hand of God is working. He is working in ways that simply are not visible. That's what faith enables us to do. You see, faith gives to us a perspective on life that it enables us to embrace the meanwhile. See, as a person of faith, if I embrace the meantime, if I embrace the meanwhile moments of life, in times that from the human perspective look barren, that look empty, that look painful, but if by faith I embrace the meanwhile, we eventually discover that something's going on. There's more to this story. This story is much bigger than my present tense circumstances. I'll say the human tendency, a secular worldview of life, is just to live from event to event. You know, we experience hardship. We wait for this. We're looking for perpetual happiness. And so we stand on one island of our present circumstances, and we're always looking to the distant island of possible happiness. And we don't embrace the meanwhile moments, the barrenness that is in between, this barrenness that allows us to see maybe what God is doing. See, Joseph never lost hope. Joseph is one of the unusual characters that we're going to study. I would say one of the more unusual, because so many of the other characters cry out to God in frustration in their humanness, like we all do. But Joseph is a man in this narrative that he never does lose heart. He's a man of such faith that he embraces this idea that something's going on. Because when the narrative picks up in chapter 39, all the way through chapter 50, the end of Genesis, we find the same refrain over and over again in the story, that the Lord was with him. Despite all the injustice that he experienced, he never lost that sense that the Lord was with him. See, the challenge to us is that even when the landscape is barren, even in seasons of dryness, even in those times and circumstances of life, when we're tempted to cry out, where is God? Where's the meaning? Where's the purpose in all of this? This is the moment for us as a people of faith to keep grinding, to keep pushing, to keep persevering, that we know good is going to come from this. Because God's hand is at work in ways that are hidden. There's another affirmation, a wonderful affirmation in this story. And it really builds upon what we have already considered, and that is that the word meanwhile affirms that our side trips are not wasted trips. That is, that the detours in life, the unexpected turns in life, that these kinds of experiences are not wasted. We all understand the principle that the closest distance between two points is what? Straight line. And most of us venture into life, especially in Western culture, we venture into life with a straight line mentality. Told the students in the last service that, you know, we come to the university because we have a plan. Nothing wrong with having a plan. And we have certain goals that define us and define our action and our energy, what we're going to do with all this. And most of us have a straight line mentality. I'm going to get this degree so I can work in this field. I'm going to get this job, and I hopefully I'm going to find this person that's going to be my spouse. We're going to have a family together. We're going to work all these years vocationally, and then we're going to retire. And we have this straight line mentality of how life is going to work. And it's really an interstate view of life. We really have this view that life is on a fast track, interstate fast track, to get me to my destination. When in fact, when you start working that plan, you soon discover that you spend more time on the farm to market roads than you do the interstate. You spend more time over here in these areas where your course and your path has been detoured, interrupted by turns and exits that you never anticipated. The line we always use at my house, and you've heard me say it before, is you make plans and you get life. Nothing wrong with having a plan. That's how we accomplish things, by having a plan. Nothing wrong with having a plan. But my experience has been is that I make plans and I get life. And what's really telling about our character and about our faith, the maturity of our faith, is how do we respond to the detours? How do I react? I can plan. That's what my plan is. My plan is how I'm going to act. But how I react to the detours, to the interruptions, that's what's more telling about my faith and my trust in the unseen hand of God working in the circumstances of life. Because what you discover is that when you've made plans and you start living life and you start spending more time out on the detours and the farm to market roads, what you discover is that when you look back, you see in those experiences, those detours, those painful moments, you see how God used those events to get you to where you are right now. It's always easier to see the purposes of God in hindsight than it is in foresight. All we know now is pain and difficulty. This isn't what I wanted to do. This wasn't the plan that I had. And yet with the passage of time and the faithfulness of God, we're able to look back and say, well, now I see. Now I see in all these past tense circumstances what God was accomplishing to get me to where I am right now. It was true for Joseph. As painful as it was being deceived by his brothers, if he had not been thrown into a pit, if they had not kidnapped him, for lack of a better term, and thrown him in that pit, he never would have been sold to the Midianites. And if he hadn't been sold to the Midianites who were traveling to Egypt, he would have never been sold to Potiphar. And if false charges had not been trumped up against Joseph by Potiphar's wife, he never would have been thrown into prison. And if he hadn't have been thrown into prison, he wouldn't have ever had the opportunity to meet the cupbearer and the baker from Pharaoh's household. He would have never had the opportunity to have interpreted their dreams. If he hadn't interpreted their dreams, he would have never had the opportunity to have been deceived by the cupbearer who said to Joseph, "I will not forget you," when in fact he did. But if he had not been forgotten by the cupbearer and left in prison, the cupbearer would have never had the opportunity to say to Pharaoh, who had a dream, "You know, I know a guy. I know a guy back in prison. And I bet he can interpret your dream." And if he had not had the opportunity to come out of prison to interpret Pharaoh's dream, he would have never been given a position of leadership and an opportunity to provide famine relief for that region of the world. It affirms time and time again that our side trips are never wasted trips. It was one cold morning, December 1914. A 67-year-old man stood on his curb watching his life work burn up. To add even more pain, he only had insurance for $238,000 when everything was worth more than $2 million. A staggering amount of money in that day. His 24-year-old son, Charles, entered into his journal that it was perhaps the most heart-rending thing that he had ever witnessed, because here's my father, a 67-year-old man who doesn't have the time to recover from this tragedy. But he said, "My father's response to me was, 'Son, go get your mother. She will never see another fire like this in her life.'" The next day, he gathered all of his employees out before the charred ruins, and he said to his employees, "You know, disasters are of great value, because all of our mistakes have been burned up." 3 weeks later, Thomas Edison delivered the first phonograph. It's but another reminder that our side trips are not wasted trips. We know the story. It comes to an end in chapter 50, as I said earlier. And there's a wonderful passage of Scripture beginning in verse 9, because now the brothers, chapter 50 is really about Jacob's death and the reaction of the brothers. They now are in fear, even though their brother Joseph has forgiven them and restored fellowship to the family. The father has died, and Joseph said to his brothers in verse 19, "Do not be afraid, for I'm in God's place. I'm in God's place." Even though you had no idea what was going to happen with what you instigated in my life, what you intended for evil, having gone through all of that, experienced all these detours in my life and in the injustices of life, all the things that were so unfair that I've experienced over these past 13 years, Joseph comes to say, "I'm in God's place. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about this present result, to preserve many people alive." Maybe that's what Paul had in mind when he wrote verse 28 of Romans chapter 8. "For we know God causes all things to work together for good for those who love God and are called according to his purpose." You know, what that verse doesn't say is just as important as what it does say. It doesn't say God causes all things. That's not the subject. That's not the emphasis of that verse. It doesn't say God causes all things. Neither does it say all things are good. Life teaches us that, doesn't it? Not all things are good. Great deal of life is unpleasant. But the assurance is, in the perspective of Joseph and Paul, because they understand the hidden agendas of God, they come to a place where they embrace and they say, all things, for I know God causes all things to work together for good. For those who love God and are called according to his purposes. Louis Braille was a young man who took a wood awl and had an accident as a child and accidentally poked himself in the eye with that wood awl, and the infection that set in soon went to his other eye, leaving him completely blind. He was sent to a school for the blind where he excelled, and as a young man, he had the opportunity to meet an army captain who introduced him to night riding. It was a way of communicating without speaking. And Braille was fascinated by this system, and he was so inspired by it that it would lead him to develop what we know and understand as the Braille system, a system by which the blind can read by touching raised dots on a piece of paper with their fingertips. What you may not know about that story is that Louis Braille developed his writing system, his reading system for the blind, using a wooden awl, the very instrument that blinded him as a child. If you hear anything this morning, I don't know all of your life circumstances. I know some of them. I don't know what your pain is. I'm not sure what chapter or season you're in your life. But whether times are good right now or times are lean, let me offer you that one word of hope. The word, meanwhile. Meanwhile. You hang on and you hang in there. Meanwhile, says there's more to your story. Let's pray together. Father, how grateful we are for your redeeming promises. That there's always more of the story to be written beyond our present circumstances. And Father, we understand that this kind of hope comes only through a personal relationship with the living Savior, with the living Christ. That as we believe in him, as we embrace him as Lord, Master, and Savior, then even our meanwhiles take on a new meaning and give to us a different perspective. But Father, I pray that as we come to this time of invitation, which is really the invitation of your Holy Spirit, that if there is someone this morning that needs to entrust their life to Jesus Christ, that, Lord, this would be the day of their salvation. If there's someone here this morning that is desiring to come and to join us, to join and be a part of this church family, a church family that is committed to being on mission, Father, we're reminded that being a part of a family is important because we bear one another's burdens. That we don't have to go through our mean time and our meanwhile alone. That you have designed us to live in fellowship with other believers. So, Father, whatever the need might be this morning, just to pray or to receive Christ as Savior, to come and to join this fellowship, Lord, we give this to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
For more information about First Baptist Church, give us a call or visit us online at firstlubbock.org. Download our mobile app to experience even more from FBC. Check out our other worship times, Sundays at 8:15, 9:30, and 11 a.m. Experience these online or come visit us at Broadway and Avenue V in Lubbock. Thanks for watching, God bless, and have a great week.